I feel as though they're doing more than just drinking water. It's like they're having a little cool down too. Just as I said this morning that the hyenas like to spend a bit of time in the water, so do the wild dogs. And well, apparently they like to use the water that they drink from as luxury facilities too, which is quite nice. Isn't that wonderful? And this is the exact kind of water hole that dear Steph likes to drink out of. So that's quite nice. Not only does he often drink elephant urine or buffalo urine or anything along those lines, we can add wild dog urine to the mix now too. But off they go. Let's keep bounding after them. Isn't this lots and lots of fun, chasing after dogs? Now they're still moving around. My goodness. Luckily for us, there's some big animal pathways and we've got a smaller, more nimble vehicle, so we're able to sneak through the bushes. Rowan, just hold on. Are you holding on? That's good. Ducking and diving through here. See, they're in between, we're back near the boundary again. They're going back towards Triple M, which is not good. Let's go this way. Please don't be a stump. Now I might have to stand up and drive. Are they crossing back again? There they are. Try and get in front. I don't know if we've got the rest of them. I think they're already ahead of us. And don't you dare cross the boundary. There they all are. All having a play. Look at them go, all chasing each other. That's really great. Let's count them quickly. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Did you see that? I hope some of you got some really cool screenshots. Maybe you'll have to go back and slow that down of that dog slipping and sliding on the floors. It just shows you apparently it is, well, tough to play on this type of substrate when you're a dog, even though you've got big nails sticking out to try and help you grip the ground. It can prove a little bit difficult. That was really funny. I don't think I've ever seen a wild dog do a tumble like that before. That was fantastic. Oh, there's some crested Franklins giving an alarm. Do you see how they all turned and looked back towards us? Now, that's not a very clever move from a crested Franklin. I think you've got to pull a move like the squirrel and just sit quietly. How cool is this though? Now, I think I counted 11. I'm not sure. They all start. I got distracted, of course, by the one dog that slid on the ground. Look at them. They're so excited. They're such sociable animals. Always sort of communicating with each other, grooming each other, making sure that the bond is tight between all of them. And it is very important that it is, because it helps sort of being connected and being in tune. And I'm going to keep going with all the members, and that helps with hunting. Right, let's see. I'm hoping that they don't disappear now. So we are going to stick on the road, but they are disappearing. Please go to the left. Please go to the left. We need all of you here. There we go. So I didn't get that name, Megan. Please can I have the name again? No? Hello, Megan? Glen's Reef. There we go. Sorry, I missed the name there for a moment with all the excitement. You're wondering, what is the social hierarchy? So what happens is normally they'll have a litter a year, normally coming into the winter months, but it's a sort of one dominant pair that does the mating. So there's a male and a female. That'll be the ones that sort of run and lead the pack, and they're the ones that are the breeders. And the rest of the dogs will actually help raise those puppies. Which is really exciting. So they can have quite a number of dogs. The most puppies I've ever seen at one go was 13, which is impressive. And then they all sort of help feed those dogs that go off hunting. And what's really nice is that there's always somebody that looks after the little ones. So unlike, I'd say, even hyenas or leopards and lions or even cheetah, when they need to go hunting, they'll leave one behind. If there's a dog that is injured in the pack, that's normally the one that stays behind and they bring back food to it. So it just shows you again how great they are when it comes to a sort of bonding with one another. They always help each other. They never leave a man behind. What we'll do is we're going to jump off here. We're going to go through this. No, I'm a bit scared now because I think there's a little bit of a drainage here. Let's not go down there and tip the car. We'll actually sneak around. We'll go up the side just like that. Hello. We're sort of playing leapfrog at the moment and sneaking, and I'm just trying to stay on the outskirts because we've got the camera and we can zoom. Now most of you said you counted 13 dogs. Okay, that sounds more like the sand pack. 13 indeed, so that's really good. That's fantastic that all of them are here. And I suppose the sub-adults are now looking less like sub-adults and more like actual adults, which is good. Right, let's squeeze through here. Through this pelt forum. That's not going to scratch the car. That's a nice soft one. And I think we've done a good choice here, just sticking to the verge, because now we're keeping out of everybody's way. They can have the sight over here. I'm just going to catch up to them again, because they're going to keep moving. Someone has already been up here by the looks of it. Right, I'm going to just put foot a bit and see if I can't get past them. Just got to keep watching out. And as they're moving through, they're covering ground, they're smelling, they're checking to see if they can pick up on anything. See, something's caught their interest there on that tree. See how they're all smelling on that guari shrub? Now that could be from anything. Maybe there was another predator that had marked their territory earlier and they're just smelling that. Dogs have got exceptionally good sense of smell. As you all know, though, most of the animals out here have got fantastic sense of smell. But the dogs, their hearing, their smell is just absolutely unbelievable. So going past there, making sure, some of them might even mark territories themselves. Doesn't look like it for the moment. I think they're just curious as to who else has been walking down the road. Let's keep moving. Now, Dr. Rob, you're wondering if there's been any studies, on sort of research done on sense of smell and hearing of wild dogs versus other dogs. Maybe. I haven't actually come across an article like that, but I reckon if you just were to search on the interweb, you would probably find something about them quite easily. I'll actually have to have a look, because I wonder, good dogs sort of to test it against are sort of the dogs they use for the bomb squad. So things like, well, good sniffer outers, could I say that? I wonder what it would be like for beagles or bloodhounds or things like that that have got a, this one's got a stick. This one is now, obviously a youngster, is not particularly interested in what the rest of the pack is doing, but it has decided to act like a real dog and play with its stick. But this is what the most amazing thing about nature is that you can sit here, and yes, we are watching wild African dogs out in the bush. However, if you're sitting at home and you've got puppies or you've got a pack of dogs of your own, you'll see that the resemblance is uncanny. It's really quite fantastic. And I'm impressed that we have been able to stay with these dogs for such a long time. I thought that they were going to disappear off our traverse relatively quickly. But they have been very, very kind to us this morning. High action, and isn't it crazy? But quiet, starting off drive. But, well, the end of drive has been absolutely great. Leopards, wild dogs, elephants, you name it. Now, Ro, you're wondering if they all have white tails. They do indeed, as you can see here, is a perfect shot of their lovely white tails. And that is very important to wild dogs, to have these long white tails that stand out like this, because when they are running, you'll see that they point them up towards the sky. And you've seen how quick a wild dog can run if you've been watching them for a number of time. Let's carry on going forward. I'm holding up everyone here. We'll just carry on. Of course, they need those and they can see them. It's sort of like a flash of white through the grass. So it helps follow each other. It's a follow me sign. And that's what you... Sorry, Rusty. Rusty's not working very well. I'm having to force it into gears. Let's keep going. That's a bit better. Now they've gone from a trot. They've picked up their pace. Let's go off-road. Sure. Now, Anisha, you've asked him, how far do wild dogs travel in a day? Very far. And I don't think there's any... Oh, wow. Look at these two having a play. Oh, the tumble again. They, oh, now they're running away again. They're quite rowdy with each other. Those two are having jumping up on their back legs. So it depends, but I've seen, I'm going to keep going forward again. I've seen wild dogs in Zambia, it was. It was pretty amazing. We saw them at the Jeki airstrip, which is probably about a 3.5 hour drive, I'd say by land cruiser. We'd seen them that morning, and that afternoon they were at our camp. All the way down near the Mozambique border, which is pretty phenomenal. So they probably traveled like 50 kilometers, maybe not quite 50, maybe between 30 and 40 kilometers in just the morning until the afternoon. So I thought that that was pretty impressive. But remember, these dogs are built for stamina, so they can just go and go and go. It's a nice cool day today. There's no need for them to sit down and have a rest. They won't be burning as much energy as what they normally would. So this is perfect. So I think they've obviously caught something a little bit earlier this morning with that blood that we saw, maybe even later last yesterday, before the sun went down. They're going again, they're running, they've turned back onto Djuma, which is great. Let's try and keep up with the other cars. We'll try and go past them. Hopefully they're gonna spot an impala. Maybe there's some impala here. And that's what they'll just do, keep moving and moving it. These dogs are amazing. There's one coming behind us. They're literally weaving in. Oh, it's coming on the other side now. They're literally weaving sort of in and out of the cars as we move. Oh, we're surrounded by dogs again. My goodness, that is so cool. Look here, look, they're gonna come right past me. Hello. That was so close, and they just don't care. This is really amazing to be surrounded by wild dogs. I think it's very special. It's one thing being surrounded by elephants and buffalo, but the predators are just absolutely phenomenal. Let's go up a bit further. There's a couple behind us, but there's also, again, quite a few of them up ahead, most of the pack. I'm going to go up on the verge again. There we go. All just moving up and down past us. And it's very quiet. Very, very, very quiet. Now, as we sit here and we watch them for the first time, they're actually being sort of quite stationary. Now, Tom, you're wondering if they're pursuing something or if they're just sort of running around. Well, normally what dogs will do in order to find food is they try and flush it out. So if they haven't got a scent or they haven't got sight or they haven't heard any potential prey, they just start moving. They start running around as a group, and sometimes they'll spread out. That's why you sort of see dogs coming from the left, coming from the right, and hopefully one of them will pick up on something, whether an animal will flee from them or an impala will give an alarm call, and then they will start their pursuit. Typically, you would like all the dogs chasing after one thing, but one adult wild dog is capable of bringing down an impala ram all on its own very easily. So if they can get more than one impala, that's better, because they live in big groups, as you can see, and they need to fill themselves up. But they'll hunt every day, if not twice a day. They've got very, very good digestive systems, and of course with running long distances and traveling quite far every single day, you need to have lots of fat reserve. Now, NBAM's life, you're wondering if they've got a favorite meal. Out here, I think the most things I've seen wild dogs taking down is impala. Impala are very important out here in the Sabi Sand. They are the bulk diet for leopards as well as wild dogs and many other carnivores out here too. So otherwise they'll go for inyala, bushbuck, really anything, as young zebra, young wildebeest, but they'll take whatever they can get. There they go, running past the car again. That's just one of the aerials, you can see. There they go. But they're just not looking in the right spots. I don't know why they keep hanging on this main road, because it's not actually often that we see a lot of impala around here. But if they were just literally turn into Vuyatela, into Djuma, there are impala everywhere. We're not far from impala plains. And I was driving around there just a moment ago, and there's definitely impala all around. And I'd actually prefer them to go back from where they came, because it would be nice if they could flush out that leopard. Look, they're going to play right here by the cars. Just shows you how they don't mind us. Look at this. We are about 2 meters away from these dogs. They're going to hop inside the car with me if they come any closer. Isn't that cool? Look at them using the cars to go around, go underneath. I've had wild dog puppies go underneath my car before. Now, Hannah, you're wondering why they don't care about the tourists at all. I suppose most of the carnivores out here, and particularly lions and wild dogs, have become very, very relaxed around around the people. And they just realize that we're not a threat to them. We're sort of just completely neutral. There's no need for us to hurt them. And also, even on foot, wild dogs are not a threat to humans. They will leave us alone. But they're playing cat and mouse now around Lex's car. Isn't that just amazing? And that's the beauty of the Sabi Sand. And it's really exciting to have all these animals up close. And I hope that all of you that are watching this could one day come out and experience this for yourself. Because it doesn't matter how I describe the sighting, it really doesn't do it any justice. Because to have wild dogs like this, look at them. They're literally using the car to run circles around. It's very, very, very special. And it is quite entertaining when there are lots of puppies around. Like I said, they'll go, no problem, go straight underneath your car and sit there. I'm just going to sit quietly, and I think we should just actually sit and enjoy this. That's incredible. They're right here, standing right next to me. They are so close. I'm trying to duck out of the way. Now, Tom, you're wondering why the dogs are endangered and what is causing their decline. Tom, there's a number of different things. Unfortunately, wild dogs in some areas are seen as pests. So at one point they were extensively hunted out because they will take down livestock. So especially in the more rural areas where you have natural reserves with all sorts of wild animals. For instance, it's a Kenya, for example. Now, even in Zambia, no, let's do Zambia because I work there. You have the game management areas and then you have the communities. And on the other side of the game management areas, you have the national park. So there's no fences between anything. The animals can move wherever they like. And once they realize that it's very easy to take down things like sheep and goats or young calves, they go, what is the point in hunting all of this other stuff? So they can get poisoned, they might get speared, they might get snared. Snaring is unfortunately a terrible thing. And then also disease amongst these dogs. Canine distemper, rabies. When one of them gets it, it's very unlikely that the rest of the pack will survive. You've seen how social they are. So diseases like that are spread very easy and will completely wipe out packs of dogs. They seem to be quite susceptible to them too, which is very sad. Very, very sad indeed, and we don't want that. But you know what? Sometimes nature says that certain animals are not meant to survive. And I'll tell you a story. This property, the owners that I work for when I was working in Zambia, they had a big game reserve in Zimbabwe. And it was really interesting to see how he said he had a pack of dogs. It was something ridiculous, like 800,000 acres of land. So a massive property. He had all the different animals. And the wild dogs were great because I'm actually going to carry on in case we lose them. He'd see the populations. He said there were about 15 of them. And then the populations would grow to about 40. And as soon as they reached that number, something would come through in canine distemper, rabies, and would completely wipe down the pack back to about 10 again. And they'd have to start again. So, you know, when I hear stories like that, and it happens, the same thing happens in Kruger, the packs just start to get really big, and then something knocks them down and brings their populations back down again. So it's almost as if, and I mean, obviously it's just my opinion, as if nature's saying, you know, let's see how strong you are and if you can really push through and move through with the species development. Look, not everything is supposed to survive as the world is changing, getting colder or getting hotter, whatever it may be. Some of the animals are definitely going to take a knock. And well, let's hope it's not the wild dogs though, because I think it's too sad to see these beautiful guys go. Very, very cool. We're going to try and get another view of them. We've just got to go around the roadblock, but let's go back across to Tristan, the bushwalk team, who is finding all of the smaller critters. Worth the wait, don't you think? Now we need to figure out which pack it is. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Maybe the, no, the Investec tech is quite big, but these all look like adults. I'm not sure. I'm never sure with these dogs. But as you know, the wild dogs are extremely relaxed and have no problem with walking right past the car. Their ears are perked, which is really good. They're lifting their heads up. I think that these lot are definitely on the search for something to eat this morning. Now, if you come onto Vuyatela, onto Djuma, there are plenty of impala for all of you to gobble up. So I reckon that you should head a little bit further east. And then you'll find yourself lots of tasty treats. Remember, that's where we just were. We had that impala ram that was chasing around the young males. And like I said, a young male impala who has been chased around by a big ram would be completely disorientated, especially when wild dogs are thrown into the picture. There could be a lot of things that happen here, because another thing that could happen is that we're not too far from where that male leopard was seen. They could also flush out that male leopard, so we're definitely going to try and stay with them. I'm going to quickly just turn around, because they're going on to Vuyatela access now. We're also still quite close towards Sydney's dam, and of course we do not want to end up losing them. Oh, and they're going towards Sydney's dam too. Thanks guys, let's see. This is fantastic. This is what a great way to start, well, it's not start, almost to end the morning. From having lots filled with lots of empty promises today, just signs. Oh, now you can hear there's actually an actual dog that's barking at the moment. Can you hear that? That's because we're at the warden's houses, so some of the anti-poaching dogs are actually based here. And that's what you can hear at the moment. And of course, the wild dogs are quite intrigued by this too. I'm going to just pull off the road very quickly, just so that the other cars can see that are behind us. So the camera is going to move around a bit. But of course, as you know, dogs are quick. They don't waste any time. They do their thing. I'd love to try and, of course, get around them. But it seems as though that's not going to be the case. So Lex and Chris, they're able to traverse onto Biffle's Hook. So we'll try and keep the lead, because if they do carry on going north and into Biffle's Hook, we're going to lose them, of course, and then they can carry on with it. Right, I'm just going to turn the game drive radio right down now. Come on, guys. Don't go into Manuleti. Please, can we just stay on Djuma? Very nice. And we might have to do a bit of maneuvering too, depending where they go to. Now I want to pull off the road just so that Lex can come through and have a look too. Now I need some help with our identification, please, of this pack of dogs. I'm not too certain which group it is. 7 adults. Maybe... Ooh, that one's got a massive injury on its back. Can you see just there on the right? Go up, 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 up. There's one of those dogs. There we go. Look at that one with a big wound on its back. Ooh. Now, I have been and haven't been around, and I haven't heard of any of the dogs with injuries. So this injury on this dog's back should be quite easy to identify. Perhaps some of you can help me if you've been watching, or if you've heard that there has been a wild dog. It looks like maybe even the alpha male, because his ears are very tattered. He looks a lot more sort of worn than the others, and normally it is the older dog. So that could be the alpha. Oh, okay. So, James, you've said that you've seen this particular pack of dogs the other day and their identification is unknown. Well, grab some screenshots. I think take as many screenshots as you can and hashtag Safari Live with them, And what we'll do is, and then share them, of course, tag us all in those pictures. And what we can do is we can try and send them off and find out exactly who they are. This is a great shot. Also, if you can get some screenshots of that male with that injury, there we go. That would help us out quite a bit too. Like I said, an injury like that stands out like an absolute sore thumb. And I'm sure that this dog would have been seen before. But what a privilege, I think, to be sitting here. You've seen southern ground hornbills with Tristan earlier, which is another one of the rare animals in Africa. And now we're with the second most endangered carnivore in Africa. Of course, the Ethiopian wolf is unfortunately ranking top in terms of the carnivores that are virtually on the brink of extinction. Wild dogs are not too far behind them. So count every day a lucky day when you get to see these painted wolves. It really is something quite special. But what a lovely group of them. Really, really nice. Very relaxed, as most of the dogs are. And they're settling a bit. They're having a little play down over there. And of course, that's a dog's. That one actually looks like it was maybe rolling in some dung of some sort. And they like to do that. They'll roll in, like your dogs at home. My dogs like to roll in chicken feces. That was their favorite thing, or ducks. But out here, elephant, rhino, buffalo dung, to try and mask their scent. Remember, wild dogs are fairly smelly. They smell like stinky cheese socks. And I've got good news. They are most certainly staying on the property, which is great news for us. And there's three vehicles here, which is good too. So hopefully between the three of us, we'll be able to keep up with them. See, the other dog was also rolling in that spot, so there must have been something that was sort of quite enticing that, well, made more than one dog stop there. Okay, well, when the dogs move, so do we. So let's quickly reposition. Oh, here we go. And we'll let Lex take the lead. Chris is coming in as well. Let Chris jump in front too. We'll let him go on in. And I think what we're going to do is, if they're going to go here, we might actually head around on the cut line, just in case they decide to go a bit further sort of east. And then we can just keep tabs on them, because like I said, remember, we're right close on the boundary. Megan, which James is this? Is this our James, or is this one of the viewer James? And pack. Okay, that's quite interesting. I have seen them a number of different times, but you know, it's so tough. Okay. Right, we're going to send you back across to James with that leopard while we reposition. We've got them, and they've come back. They went onto Biffle's hook, and then they came back again. They're running through all this lovely long grass, which is really quite beautiful. And there's a massive herd of impala, because I had to do a big loop around towards Aubrey's, because that's where they ran. And being just like wild dogs, they hit the brakes, and then they went straight north. But now they're back again. And this is it, though. Dogs, if you knew what I've just seen, you would be running as fast as you can. I've actually just noticed this dog over here that's just coming in to join the pack on the left. There we go. It's just come into screen now. Actually looks like maybe it is a younger one, or maybe it's a female, but she has a bit of blood. Can we go to the one on the right? It's got blood on its neck if you look very carefully. So I think that they've already caught something this morning. They must have caught one thing. Can you see that there? There's just faint sort of blood, and they typically have a lot of blood around their face, around their ears when they do make a kill. And the same thing was on, well, the other one on the other side of her head. So I reckon that they have caught something, maybe something small, maybe something like a dacre, but it is very difficult. And I think there's more than seven now. Chris was saying that three more joined the party just as we sort of moved off to give everyone a bit of room. So I think there's 10 in total, which would make it sound a bit more like the sand pack, because there's quite a few of them. Right, now this is the fun part. Ready to follow. Let's try and do this without crashing. It's normally a little bit difficult. Right. Now, as I try and maneuver around here. I'm going to try and answer as many questions of yours as I can. John, you're wondering if wild dogs pose a significant threat to a leopard. Well, it depends, John. If the leopard is not quick enough to climb up of the tree, then yes, definitely. You've seen what wild dogs do to hyenas, I'm sure. Highly entertaining. But most of the time, the leopards, all these animals have got such keen senses, they can pick up on something like that. They're just in the thicket now. Haven't decided what they're doing just yet. But let's watch the dogs. It's because they could disappear at any moment. Like I said, leopard gets up the tree quick enough, they know. If it's down on the ground and hasn't got anywhere to go, it could find itself in a little bit of trouble. But normally, things like that don't always happen. A young, inexperienced leopard, possibly. An older leopard, a big male leopard, he'd probably sort of swipe at those wild dogs. And they'd have to be careful because a leopard could easily kill a wild dog too. We've seen it very unfortunately with the lions. There they are. They're running all there. Actually, we're being surrounded, as you can see, by wild dogs coming in from the left, coming in from the right. The impala are alarming. Here they come. Here they all are, next to the car. There we go. There's a whole lot of them coming out on the left. There they all are. Now, safari, you're wondering if dogs have the highest success rate of hunting. It depends. Like with everything and anything, of course, with the dogs moving, we're going to have to keep moving too. They've got a very good success rate. Sometimes the dogs, unfortunately, don't win either. That definitely happens. But if they keep going towards Aubrey's and towards sort of sandy patch, well, all that side going down there, there's a massive herd of impala. Lots of youngsters, lots of rams, lots of females. So they'll have quite a number of impala to choose from. And normally what happens when they go racing into a herd of mammals is they start to panic. And this is great. Animals like frenzied animals because they're not concentrating. They don't quite know what to do. And normally they make a mistake. And that's where the dogs will come in. The same, it goes for a leopard, for a lion as well. They love it when they all start running in different directions. Right, so we're just driving over all the small shrubs, trying to keep in front of them. Because if we get stuck behind these dogs, it's always more difficult. But here they are. We'll just watch them go quickly, and then I found another gap that we can take. But there they go. There's lots of them now. So there's at least 10, maybe even a few more. There's actually a squirrel. Let's have a look at the squirrel very quickly that's on the tree watching just on this knob thorn. He's watching the dogs. Go down, there we go, straight in, go down, straight in. Look at that squirrel watching very carefully, making sure that the dogs don't try and catch it. It's not even alarming at the moment. It might start alarm calling once they are further away. You're a very lucky little squirrel. How cool is that? Finally, I got to put my squirrel on camera with wild dogs. That's even better than I could have asked for. Right, now we're going to keep up with the dogs again. But that's funny. I'm surprised that that squirrel wasn't shouting and alarming it at the dogs and letting everybody else know. Okay, hold on here. They're running again. Oh, no, they've just stopped. They started running and then they stopped. We just have to go through some of this stuff. Okay, we're going to keep searching here. The dogs are on the move. We're going to do a bit of, well, fast driving. Tristan has found some termites and they don't, well, I don't think they're going to go anywhere.